Hello, this is a virtual microscopy slide of a case of tuberculous meningitis or TB meningitis involving the cerebellum. This is the area of the meninges or the subarachnoid space. Here we have viable cerebellar parenchyma. This is the fourth ventricle. And over here we have some white matter and gray matter just around the fourth ventricle. Let's do a very quick recap of normal histology first, starting with the fourth ventricle, and we can see that the ventricle is lined by a single layer of cuboidal to low columnar epithelium, and these are ependymal cells. Adjacent to this, we can see the white matter, which is predominantly composed of glial cells, including astrocytes, as we can see here with the small round to oval nuclei. And moving to this area, we begin to see some large neurons, and this is the periventricular gray matter. We can see these roughly triangular shaped neurons with large open or vesicular nuclei and prominent nucleoli, and there is also some brown lipofuscin pigment within the cytoplasm. And there are many astrocytes in the surrounding parenchyma. Here again, we can see some neurons. And let's move on to the cerebellum. The cerebellar cortex is composed of three layers: the molecular layer, the Purkinje cell layer, where we can see very large neurons, and the very cellular blue appearing granular layer. In the molecular layer, we see mostly the dendritic processes of these Purkinje cells and some interneuronal cells. And in the Purkinje area, we can see these large neurons with their dendritic processes joining up with the molecular layer. And finally, the granular layer, which is composed of these very uniform, round, blue-looking cells with minimal cytoplasm. This cerebellar parenchyma is unremarkable, it is viable, and there is no involvement by TB. Let's move on to the abnormal area, which is this entire area here. This is the expanded subarachnoid space. And if we look in this region, we can see that there is a lot of this amorphous eosinophilic areas, which are areas of necrosis. And we can also see this eosinophilic fibrillary material, which is fibrin, and hence the exudate is usually whitish or grayish in color. Over here, we can see a necrotizing granuloma. So we have epithelioid histiocytes or macrophages, which form the granuloma. And then within the central area, there is this amorphous eosinophilic material, which is necrosis, hence necrotizing granuloma. And we also have these scattered multinucleated giant cells. These are known as Langhans cells, as the nuclei are arranged in a horseshoe shape pattern. In this particular cell, the nuclei appear to be arranged in a ring, and this is because of the plane of sectioning. Around the granuloma, we can also see lots of chronic inflammatory cells, which are composed mostly of lymphocytes, as well as some plasma cells. Here we can see the plasma cells better, with eccentric round nuclei and a moderate amount of cytoplasm. Another plasma cell here, as well as small lymphocytes. This is an area where the granulomatous inflammation is seen around a blood vessel, and we have a central blood vessel here, we have this area of necrosis, and lots of epithelioid histiocytes forming the granuloma, and for this reason, the blood vessels can undergo fibrinoid necrosis as well as thrombosis, and this can lead to infarction of the area of supply in the brain parenchyma. Here is another such area where we can see necrosis, granulomas comprising these epithelioid histiocytes, Langhans type giant cells, and we have a blood vessel here that is damaged with some proliferation in the subintimal tissue. Let's learn a bit more about tuberculous meningitis. There is also a video describing the gross pathological features of TB meningitis using this interactive virtual pathology specimen, and this video can be found in our free online pathology resource, Pathweb. Registration is completely free, and you can find the link in this video description. So TB can infect the CNS in several ways, as a meningitis, as seen here, where there is infection in the subarachnoid space. Also, there can be direct parenchymal infection and a combination in TB, meningoencephalitis. The pathogenesis is due to hematogenous dissemination, usually from pulmonary TB, where the organisms can reach the CNS as well as the subarachnoid space. And this can also occur in adults who become immunocompromised, for example, and can get a reactivation of TB. Clinically, there may be systemic symptoms such as a low-grade fever, loss of weight, and night sweats, as well as more site-specific symptoms of meningitis, including headache, neck stiffness, and photophobia. Grossly, at the base of the brain and also sometimes over the cerebral hemispheres, we will usually see these grey gelatinous exudates, and they can also appear to be yellowish or whitish, and sometimes with nodular granular areas. Again, the gross appearance is described in a separate video that is available in our virtual pathology museum in Pathweb. Microscopically, within the subarachnoid space, we will see the characteristic inflammatory picture of TB, which is that of necrotizing granulomatous inflammation. And here we can see again at low magnification the cerebellar parenchyma, and this is the markedly expanded subarachnoid space, which contains lots of blood vessels as well as necrotizing granulomatous inflammation. Here is a higher magnification view. We can see over here an area of necrosis within a large granuloma, and often the inflammation will be very closely associated with the leptomeningeal vessels. Here we can see a blood vessel, and there is a necrotizing granuloma here comprising these epithelioid histiocytes and areas of necrosis, and this can also give rise to proliferative changes in the blood vessel intima, fibrinoid necrosis, and thrombosis. Here is another necrotizing granuloma with a Langhans giant cell and also accompanying lymphocytes and plasma cells. And here is one example of a blood vessel with this subintimal proliferation. And again, we can see here this granulomatous inflammation comprising epithelioid histiocytes. These are admixed with lymphocytes as well as many Langhans type giant cells. In summary, this is a virtual microscopy slide showing the features of tuberculous meningitis, where the subarachnoid space is full of necrotizing granulomatous inflammation as well as chronic inflammation. Over here, we have a necrotizing granuloma, the granuloma being composed of epithelioid histiocytes with an area of central necrosis, and very often the leptomeningeal blood vessels are also damaged, giving rise to thrombosis and potential infarction of the brain parenchyma. Thank you.